Independence Day, folks! You're watching a special July the 4th edition of That Should Be a Movie. Today's historical event that I like to pitch as an epic summer blockbuster release is one full of plenty of John Wayne heroics, Michael Bay explosions, and those J.J. Abrams flares there. We're talking great American comeback story, Rocky Balboa underdog kind of stuff. We're talking about the Philadelphia campaign of 1777 and 1778, Pilgrim! Yeehaw! In my research for this episode, I consulted too many books to name here. And then there's these titles I didn't even get to. In fact, I had so much fun doing so much research, I just might do individual episodes on each of the 9 rounds in the future. Stay tuned! Round 1 between the underdog United Colonies and the undisputed reigning champion Great Britain starts off in New Jersey. The main contenders are, in the right corner, General George, his mother was hit by lightning while carrying him, Washington. And in the left corner, we have General Sir William Howdy, the old man, Hal. After Washington, Kinney punched the Redcoats at Trenton and Princeton, the British pulled back to the coastal region of New Jersey. Howe spends the spring and early summer of 1777 trying to lure the Continental Army out of their corner in Morristown. No large battles occur as Howe tries to cut the ring, but Washington backpedals. Finally, the British were like, "What the heck? It's New Jersey. You can have it." The British capture an American spy named Abram Patton. After he tried to rabbit punch them by blowing up their ammunition magazines in Brunswick on King George III's birthday, his final words at his public hanging were, "I die for liberty." Then, General Howdy Doody receives instructions from his trainers back in jolly old England to cooperate with General John, Gentleman Johnny, Burgoyne as he marches south from Canada in order to cut New England off from the other colonies. But he instead decides to combine this movement with capturing the capital of the rebellion, Philadelphia. In European warfare, capturing an enemy capital was always a psychological KO. He loads his men onto the ships of his brother, Admiral Earl Richard Black Dick Howe. Washington has no idea where Howe's going. Is he going to Canada to help Burgoyne? Is he going to attack Charleston, South Carolina? Is he going to try to capture Boston? He learns with Caesar Rodney, a signer of the Declaration of Independence, sends him a rider to alert him that the British are in Delaware Bay. Now Washington knows that the Brits intend to deliver a punch to the city of brotherly love. But then the Royal Navy backpedals down the Delaware. On August 12th, American signal guns greet them as they enter Chesapeake Bay. With 266 ships, it will be the largest armada to be assembled off the American coast until the Civil War. It's like something out of Pirates of the Caribbean. Only cooler, because it's real. In order to lift morale, Washington has the army parade for 2 hours through Philadelphia in front of the Continental Congress. Called the Grand Army, they are composed of Irish, Germans, Poles, Brits, Scots, and African-American freemen. The green sprigs they wore on their hats did not hide the fact that they were amateur lightweights. Then Washington watches the British unload at Head of Elk. From atop Gray's Hill, it is believed that he and Hal spied each other in a real face-off. Washington tells his men, "The eyes of all America and of Europe are turned upon us, and the most important moment is at hand, where glory waits to crown the brave." The news is nearly all bad. Daniel Morgan, No, not that Morgan. And his elite riflemen have been called away to stop Burgoyne and the Locomuso run away from the heavyweight British. The first blows land when Washington tells the British,
"You shall not pass!"
At Cook's Bridge are Iron Heel, and the bloody Brits are the winners. Legend has it that Iron Heel is the first sign that the American flag, the Stars and Stripes, flew over U.S. troops during battle. Round 2 occurs along the Brandywine.
How far to the nearest crossing?
Brandywine Bridge.
No, that's not the Brandywine we're talking about. This is George Washington's first serious attempt to block Hal's drive towards Philadelphia.
Get away from her, you...
Harlot, he is also planning to launch his first major offensive against a significant part of the British Army during the American Revolution. On the eve of battle, Reverend Jacob Trote leads the troops in a devotion.
Patriot feeling, Spiritus Sancti.
GW places his men to guard Chad's Ford and believes fake news that the next fords on the Brandywine are many miles away. He tells his men, "Now then is the time for most strenuous extortions. One bold stroke will free the land from raping, devastations, and burning, and female innocence from brutal lusts and violence. If we behave like men, this third campaign will be our last. Hashtag time's up." The first shots are fired at 6 a.m. on 9/11, as men under William Maxwell open fire on the advancing troops of Hessians under Wilhelm Knipsen. American infantry fires and falls back to pre-arranged concealed positions, slowing the Imperials down. One of these Americans is future Chief Justice of the United States, John Marshall. He was Marshall. 3 full hours of sharp ambush firing and fitful skirmishing follow until the Hessians force the Americans across the Brandywine. The colonial cannons on the far side of the Brandywine began firing on them. One cannonball hit an ammunition wagon. The Hessians are joined by riflemen under Patrick Ferguson. It is believed that Ferguson once had General Washington in his sights, but did not toot him because he admired how well he was carrying out his duties. Washington is joined by a young Frenchman named Marie-Joseph Paulvis Roots Gilbert de Petit. Let's just call him Lafayette. Washington is supposed to keep him out of harm's way. He just doesn't know this. Despite fires obscuring their vision, it appears the Americans are winning. But Howe is dissenting and is now bringing his overhead over Jeffrey's Ford upriver. It's a near total repeat of Jamaica Pass at the Battle of Long Island from a year earlier. Washington receives conflicting reports about what is going on, and according to local legend, it takes an old man named Thomas Cheney to convince him of the British movement. That could be in a movie. Who cares what Brandon F. says?
Scene. By God, sir, look at your cap!
Washington sends the divisions of Nathaniel Green, John Sullivan, Adam Stephen, and William Alexander, aka Lord Stirling, to meet this thrust at Birmingham Friends, no, not those friends, Meeting House. Among Sterling's men is future President James Monroe, Maxwell's riflemen, John Armstrong's Pennsylvania militia, and the division of Mad Anthony Wayne, whose name would be bestowed on this American icon a century and a half later, were left to guard Chad's Ford. At Birmingham Meeting House, the Americans, especially Woodford's Virginians, with a shout out to the 3rd Virginia, put up a spirited fight. They waited until the enemy was within 6 rods of them before opening fire. Thomas Conway, a seasoned combatant of European wars, said he never saw so close and severe a fire. But it is 5,300 Americans who are about to face off against 9,000 British troops and their allies. With bayonet charges and flanking movements, while their band plays the British Grenadiers, the Brits drive the Americans off the field in one of the most spectacular military moments ever to occur on the North American continent. The rebels are sent into a headlong retreat. Lafayette tries to rally them, but is wounded in the thigh. He does not dress his wound until that night, after helping form a defensive line at Chester. Meanwhile, back at Chad's Ford, Ferguson and the Hessians stop bobbing weaving and struck at the Americans. Wayne's men are outnumbered 3-1, and he is forced to fall back at 2 p.m., but not before turning the Brandywine waters red with British blood. A cannonade covers his men's retreat as they fall back, firing from behind fences, walls, houses, and ditches for an hour and a half. Cavalry charge led by the Polish cavalier Casimir Pileski of 30 horsemen help halt the British advance, and the final shots are fired by Greene's men as the sun goes down. Thus ends one of the longest and largest battles of the American Revolution. American casualties are nearly 1,000, while British losses are over 600. It is obvious the British were much better drilled than the Americans, and that the Continental soldiers did not understand tactics. One British officer referred to the rebels as banditry. However, other royal officers thought differently. In fact, the Americans had fought so hard that General Howe thought Sullivan's 1,000 men had been 10,000 troops. The German commander, Burmeister, admired the Americans even as they fought off his Hessians. But more important was the attitudes of the Americans. As they retreated, the soldiers could be heard saying, "Come on, boys, we shall do better another time." Nate Green wrote, "We fight, we get beat, rise and fight again." Washington decreed, for their gallant behavior, each man would get one deal per day of rum while it lasts. America, Battle 3 is a massacre at Paoli. Washington tries to check hook Howe at a six-point crossroads in the Great Valley, but rain ruins the ammunition and the powder of the troops. This rain also providentially kept the Imperials from seriously KOing Washington. This draw became known as the Battle of the Clouds, or the Rumble in the Clouds. Next, Washington sends Wayne to meet up with William Smallwood's militia to do a tying up on Howe's rear. Wayne's men camp near a tavern named after the Corsicanan rebel Pascal Paoli. However, before the Americans can deliver a knockout, Loyalists alert the British. On the night of September 20th, the British, led by Major General Charles Grey, a real brawler, including the 42nd Highland Infantry Regiment, the Black Watch, approached the American camp under cover of darkness. Grey tells his men to remove the flints from their guns, earning him the nickname, No Flints Grey. The attack was so sudden that Wayne would later be accused of being caught with his guard down. A court-martial would later clear his name. Most of the gunfire that lit up the night came from American pickets and pockets of resistance. However, it was the fierce use of the bayonet by the British that carried the battle into a resounding American defeat. 54 Americans were killed and many more wounded and captured. Many of the American POWs were gruesomely wounded from the bayonets. While the fight at Paoli was small, it had a profound emotional impact. Washington had to send Alexander Hamilton, yes, that Hamilton, to let Congress know that Philly had to be evacuated. All the papers of the Continental Congress and the Liberty Bell had to be moved to the new capital at York, Pennsylvania. But more importantly, the nightmare of Wayne's affair became a rallying cry for Americans. Gruesome stories of the dead and living turned into pincushions by multiple bayonet wounds spread far and wide, turning the battle into a massacre. The British 52nd Light Company became known as the Bloodhounds, and Remember Paoli became a rallying cry in the grand tradition of American rallying cries like Remember the Alamo, Remember the Maine, Remember Pearl Harbor, Remember 9/11, and remember to like this video and subscribe to this channel. Round 4 takes place at Germantown. On September 26, Howe and the British Army enter the deserted capital. Crowds of Loyalists turn out to greet him. In a jab at the Americans, they have green sprigs in their horses' tails. But Washington is back in the ring. with Wayne and Smallwood back. He sees an opening when the British station troops just beyond Philly at Germantown. He decides on a lead weight after two letters are intercepted that reveal Howe has sent 3,000 of his men to New Jersey, poor guys, to attack the American outpost which are guarding the Delaware River. The time is ripe for an attack. On the morning of October 4th, the Americans are like,
knock, knock.
Now the British are taken by surprise. Wayne's men cry, have at the bloodhounds. Revenge Wayne's affair. With bayonets, they take revenge for Paoli. The British 5th Regiment charge the Americans twice, but were driven off each time until their numbers were reduced to a battalion by killing and wounding. General Howe, galloping up to the scene, could not believe it.
For same, light infantry, I never saw you retreat before. Form! Form!
It's only a scouting party.
Then the American cannon suddenly appeared and fired grapeshot. The soldiers enjoy watching the general, who had just accused them of being cowards, cower as lead flies by his ears. Victory seems in grasp, except for Colonel Thomas Musgrave and 120 men of the 40th Foot who have barricaded themselves inside a stone house called Clivenden. Henry Knox convinces Washington that a fort should not be left in the rear, and an attack is ordered. Despite constant infantry attacks and cannon bombardment, the British stronghold refuses to fall. The soldiers of Maxwell's light infantry, who actually enter the building, were bayoneted to death. The Continentals attempted to push a fire wagon to the front door, but were driven back. John Lawrence, yes, that John Lawrence, and a French volunteer, Thomas de Plazy, approached the house with burning straw. Lawrence was wounded in the shoulder, but de Plazy managed to make it inside. However, he only escaped capture when a British private accidentally shot the officer who had taken him prisoner. Not so lucky were Majors John White, who was shot when he snuck into the house with a lighted torch, and Edward Schuber, who was killed when he was bayoneted through the mouth. In all, 56 Americans died in a futile attempt to take Clivenden. Elsewhere, fog and smoke shrouded the battlefield. Commanders, lost and confused, led their men towards the firing at Clivenden. There are incidents of friendly fire between the Continentals. General Stephen will later be removed for drunkenness during battle.
America.
And the soldiers, not realizing how close they were to enemy lines, began shouting that they were out of ammunition. The British, hearing this, charge, and Washington orders a retreat. Meanwhile, Nate Green continues to press his attack. Unaware of the army's retreat, some of his regiments penetrate the British lines deep enough to plunder abandoned huts. Their shouts of joy alert other British units, which counterattack. Some of the Continentals hold up in Market Square Church before they surrender. The rebels retreat in good order. The famous pamphleteer, Thomas Paine, who served as an aide to Greene, said the retreat was extraordinary. While admitting they needed more training, he wrote Ben Franklin that the men were disappointed, not defeated, more displeased at the retreat than in a hurry to get away. Nobody hurried themselves. Because of this battle, Howe pulls his troops back to Philly. The Continental Army had gone the distance. Round 5 is a split between Fort Mercer and Fort Mifflin. The British themselves are not yet in the clear. The two American forts, Mercer and Mifflin, guard the Delaware River, keeping food and supplies from being delivered to the army and the city. An elaborate defense system, including savoir de flares planted in the Delaware riverbed to disembowel ships, had been designed by the Polish engineer Thaddeus Kosciuszko. British Captain John Monstrester began building batteries less than a mile from Fort Mercer, but American raids, commando style, slowed down the progress. On October 2nd, 1777, Fort Billingsport falls to the British Navy, but not before the Americans escape after spiking the guns and setting the barracks on fire. Howe is running out of supplies, and with no timetable from Monstressor, he begins planning an attack upon the forts. On October 22nd, 1777, 1,200 Hessians, led by Colonel Carl van Denop, seeking revenge for the humiliation of Trenton, attack Fort Mercer. Inside are only 400 Americans, led by Nate Green's cuz, Christopher Green, who orders his men to fire low. They have a broad just above the hips. Aim at that. Van Denop demands that the fort surrender or no quarter will be given. A Lieutenant Jeremy Onwe replies, "We shall not ask for nor expect any quarter, and mean to defend the fort to the last extremity." The Hessians attack the fort, scaling the outer walls and getting inside, and believe victory is at hand. But the Americans had built a fort within a fort. Concealed artillery and infantry let loose volleys of crossfires. Canister blasts tear holes in the German lines. It's like Indiana Jones fighting Nazis in Raiders of the Lost Ark. Only cooler, because it's real. Von Denop is killed, and the Hessians retreat, leaving the fort to the colonists in a resounding American victory. Meanwhile, the British Navy tried to attack Fort Mifflin at the same time, but several ships ran aground. The siege of that fort lasted from September 26 to November 16, 1777. On November 8, the Royal Navy squadron passed the Surveyor de Flares, thanks to a traitor. The Americans only had 4 cannons on that side of the fort. The Pennsylvania Navy came up to help. What followed was a contest of epic proportions, involving 350 cannons. It would be the largest concentration of fire on American soil until the Civil War. The fort was pounded into ruins. Americans had to dig out unexploded British cannonballs from the mud to fire back at the Jacks. The Americans sent fire ships to disrupt the British Navy. The HMS Augusta is set on fire, and when the flames reach her magazine, explodes! On November 15th, the American commander, Simon Thayer, ordered Fort Mifflin abandoned, evacuating his men to Fort Mercer. He set fire to the supplies that remained. But he left the American flag flying, a symbol that the fort had never surrendered. America! On November 15th, the Continentals evacuated Fort Mercer and then blew it up. The Pennsylvania Navy had no protection and nowhere to go now, so they set their 15 ships afire. The whole city of Philadelphia came out to watch the fire show. Now Howe can supply his men. It's like in Rocky IV when Drago kills Apollo Creed. Round 6, GW staggers around the ring at White Marsh. After the falls of Forts M&M, the Americans and British parry back and forth with a few small skirmishes. December 5th through 8th sees skirmishing at White Marsh as Howe swings at the Americans. Washington was alerted to Howe's plans by Lydia Darga. He knows he's too close, so he backs up. The British set fire to the houses outside the city limits in order to deprive the Americans of cover. Once again, the citizens of Philly climbed to the roofs to watch the show. Howe probed the lines of the battered, starving, and cold Continental Army at White Marsh for a few days, then backpedals. After the British withdrawal, the soldiers rush forward to gather abandoned blankets and kettles. Washington realizes that his army will always be in danger when it is less than a day's march away from Philly. He must find a new location. Round 7 is the one that makes or breaks the Continental Army at Valley Forge. Army, after a march which left bloody footprints in the snow, arrived at the forge and began building log huts, 14 feet wide, 15 feet long, and 6.5 feet high, for 12 men squads to live in. Washington offers a reward of $100 to whomever found the best roofing material. On December 25th, the body of a free man of color named Jethro was found in a hut. He had died of malnutrition and exposure. He was the first of 3,000 Americans to die at Valley Forge for our freedom. At VA, W faced many challenges. He faced logistical problems. Fortunately, Nate Green stepped up and helped smooth out the commissary department, and with the help of the Oneida Nation, fed the army. Washington faced mutiny. Soldiers huddled around their fires chanted, "No meat, no coat, no blanket, no soldier." He faced desertions and the resigning of officers. He faced a civilian population that would rather sell food to the enemy that paid in the king's gold than to his men in exchange for worthless Continental dollars. He wrote the neglectful Continental Congress that the army must starve, dissolve, or disperse. He faced several diseases. One disease, smallpox, he fought with inoculations. He faced the Conway Cabal, in which his acolytes, like Lafayette, fear that Thomas Conway was conspiring with James Wilkerson and Horatio Gates, the so-called hero of the Battle of Saratoga, which had ended with the capture of Burgoyne and his army, to have him replaced. His leadership faced criticism from leading revolutionaries like John Adams. Through it all, his superb leadership and perseverance of character got him and the army through the winter. No doubt the arrival of Martha Washington helped cheer things up. At Valley Forge, she would host the first ever public celebration of Washington's birthday. For the Brits, it was always sunny in Philadelphia. Aside from the Battle of the Kegs, in which the fleet responded with a cannonade to mined kegs floating in the Delaware River, they lived in relative ease and pleasure. One of the myths of Valley Forge is that it was the coldest and harshest winter that the Continental Army ever faced. Morristown, from a year earlier, saw much deprivation, to the point of soldiers eating the soles of their shoes. The coldest winter would be later in 1780, when they faced Arctic conditions. Valley Forge's temperatures, on the other hand, were relatively mild, which did add to the agony since the melting snow made the ground muddy and hard to walk on. What makes Valley Forge important is the training that soldiers received from Frederick Wilhelm van Steuben. After he overcame a language barrier and a cultural barrier, in which Americans would only do what was required of them if they knew the reason why, he began to make professional soldiers out of civilians. While there is some debate on whether he really was a baron or not, what is not up to debate is that his training of the American army was not barren. He taught the men to wheel into formation when the long roll was played. He taught them to march in double rank and to quick step. He made sure officers did officers' things while sergeants did sergeant things. He taught them the difference between marching formations for brigades and platoons, the proper arms to be carried by the men into battle. He instilled in them a discipline that made them proud of themselves. Soon Valley Forge was clean, as the men buried old latrines, dug new ones, and hauled away months of trash. Why? I feel a training montage coming on.
You're gonna kill him!
With April came news of the new Franco-American alliance. This prompted the Brits to send the Carlisle Peace Commission to offer a bill of conciliation to the Continental Congress, which gave the colonies everything they wanted if they just came back to Mother England. But the Americans replied,
"You're fired."
To celebrate the new army and the Treaty of Alliance, Lafayette recommends a feu de joie, a fire of joy. Cannons roared as 10,000 men marched by in review in front of G.W., who sat on his white Arabian stallion. The infantry displays 6 weeks of training by wheeling and reforming. Then there is a cascade of musketry fire from line to line. Then three cheers. Long live the King of France. Long live the friendly European powers. To the American states. Round 8 is Lafayette's turn to go the distance at Barren Hill. Meanwhile, in Philadelphia, Hal, due to his Whig politics and the emptiness of capturing a city when the government would just move the capital to another location, resigned. Now Clinton, no, not that Clinton, Sir Henry Clinton, was in charge of the army. With him, the gloves were off. With France entering the war, the British now had to defend several fronts around the world from King Louis's aggression. Philadelphia was worthless to them, and the orders from the coaches in London were to consolidate forces at New York. As he evacuated the city, Clinton realized that he could not take the whole army and the loyalist population on ships, so he made plans to march the army across New Jersey. Poor guys. In May, rumors were brewing in Valley Forge about the British evacuating, so Washington gave Lafayette his full command. Lafayette takes 2,000 troops to gather intelligence about these rumors. Lafayette led his men to Barren Hill, northwest of Philadelphia, and set up his headquarters there. Hal and Quinton decided to trap him, with three columns of 2,000 men each, including one led by No Flinch Gray, would circle Barren Hill and capture the Continentals. However, the American pickets spy the approaching Imperials. With Lafayette alerted, he quickly rallied his men, silently marched them out of the trap. Their tactical retreat was covered by Daniel Morgan's riflemen and the Oneida Indians. This is the first test and exhibit of Van Steuben's training. The next morning, the British are astonished to see each other climbing the hill instead of Continentals there. Hal couldn't believe the men who escaped were the same army his men had beaten so many times before. Clinton was even more disdainful, contributing the escape to rugged terrain and good luck on part of the Continentals. And the final round is at Monmouth Courthouse! With the likes of John Adams doubting his generalship, Washington gives chase the Quinton's column. But first, he must settle a dispute of rank between General Charles Lee and Lafayette. Lee, paroled after being captured in 1776 and writing up for the British a plan to capture America, by military standard deserves the higher rank. Lafayette steps aside and allows Lee to have command. Lee still despises Washington, saying he is not fit to lead a sergeant's guard. He also doesn't believe that the Americans are ready to fight the British. Maxwell's infantry and the militias slow Quinton's column down, burning bridges and failing trees in their way while sniping at him. They leave posters up saying, "We will begoin you." Skirmishes break out, and at one point the British burn a house down on some riflemen who refuse to surrender. If the British had been paying attention, they would have noticed that the American regulars and militia were working better together than they had the year before. The Americans finally catch up to the British at Monmouth Courthouse when the British had stopped to plunder the place. Washington has a huddle with his generals. Lee is still against an attack because he does not believe Van Steuben has trained the soldiers well enough. Still, Washington orders his army to go for Quentin. Lee, reconnoitering the area, decides he can cut off and capture the British rear guard, including Quentin's baggage, forcing it to surrender without a costly battle. Quentin, seeing Lee's movements, rushes his soldiers through the June heat to save his baggage. In response to Quentin's swing, Lee orders a retreat. Quentin, watching from Briar Hill, decides to go for a haymaker and destroy the rebels with his classic move from Long Island. He orders his men to go into Lee's rear. In response, Lee orders a retreat. Two of Wayne's regiments have a heavy fight on their hand, but they cover Lee's retreat. Pick out the kingbirds, Wayne told his men, referring to the officers. The retreat is an orderly testament to Van Steuben's training. Washington is astonished to see the soldiers marching away from battle. In a famous scene in which some claim G.W. sweared until the leaves trembled, he confronted Lee at a place called Point of Wood. Washington took over command and began to order the men to battle at Point of Wood and along a hedgerow. Alexander Hamilton says, "I will die on the spot, if you please." The British attack and drive the Americans out of Point of Wood. In this fight, they come into hand-to-hand combat and realize they are facing a new breed of soldiers. After an epic and violent charge, the Americans are driven from the hedgerow. However, Van Steuben's training is there to see as the army performs a retrograde movement in the face of the enemy that a year before would have resulted in a panic. It is said that Van Steuben cried when he saw his men performing so well. The Americans fall back to Perrin Ridge. Here the British realize they cannot turn the American flanks. There will be no Long Island today! 16 American artillery pieces slug it out with 46 British guns in an artillery duel that lasted for 2 hours and became known as the Great Cannonade. An American legend is born as several women run water to cool the guns and the men manning them. And one of these women, Mary Hayes, helps swab a gun after her husband is wounded, giving birth to Molly Pitcher. It's like,
"No man can kill me.
I am no man."
Only cooler, because it's real. Then the British go for the jugular and attack the new American line. But the Americans fight back, firing specially designed balls to inflict maximum damage. It is a slugfest in the hot summer afternoon sun. Men go crazy from thirst. Others collapse with exhaustion. Washington and his aides, Lawrence and Hamilton, both have horses sought from beneath them. Washington's servant, Billy Lee, gives him his horse. Men die from heat stroke. Both Washington and Quentin lead their men near the front. An American almost kills Quentin and pays for it with his life. Finally, Clinton, his baggage secure and realizing he cannot force the new model American army off the ridge, orders his men to retreat. Washington sends out probing forces under Wayne to harass the British rear and go for a belly punch. The British attack these probes, but are unable to pursue them because a southpaw from De Plazy's artillery sends them staggering to the ropes. Thus ends one of the largest and longest battles of the American Revolution and the last major battle of the war in the northern colonies. Nearly 2,000 men are casualties. While historians have come to a majority draw on who won the battle since the British continued their march with all their baggage to the coast, that is not what matters. What matters is that the new American army had proven itself in battle against the world's finest military. Its discipline, training, and hard work had paid off. It had gone the distance! A few days later, as the British prepared to sail across the bay to New York, they heard firing in the distance. It was the Americans celebrating July the 4th. Then they hear George's thundering voice, "Yo, Martha! I did it!" Because it is an inspirational and motivational story of patriotic Americans going the distance until their training and discipline paid off as the final bell rings, is why I think the Philadelphia campaign of 1777 and 1778 should be an epic July the 4th weekend blockbuster release! Thank you for watching, Pilgrim. Be a good American and like and subscribe below. Or be a great American and share this video with all the freedom-loving people of the world! Paid off as the final bell rang, is why I think this Philadelphia